Hey fellas, so I'm about to add some of the washes to the diorama base. It's all been gloss coated now. It's been drying for probably around 3 or 4 hours now, so it's pretty dry. The washes that I'll add is, I'm not so sure I'm going to add any of the dark dirt. I was considering adding some of the dark dirt just along the curbs. But I think that what I'm going to do is I'll use earth. I'll use the UMP's earth for along the curbs and along dark areas and along the grass. And then I'm going to use, this is a mix of UMP sand and concrete and light dirt. And I use it for a lot of different things. But I use it a lot for cobblestone type work. I'm going to use it for the roadway, and for this I'm going to use concrete for the mortar for back here. So that's the idea anyway. Now I'm not going to show me applying the entire thing because it's actually going to take quite a bit of time to apply to the entire surface, but you'll get the gist from what you'll see here, hopefully anyway. So, because this is a clay-based wash, you got to shake the living snot out of them to get the particulates floating back into the suspension. Now, some folks like to pour it into a little cup and dole it out from the little cup. I don't do that because whenever I pour it back out of the cup into the bottle, there's always a bunch of particulates left in the bottom of the cup that I can't get out. And when I do that, it thins the mixture as a whole over time. I lose the density to the color after a while if I keep doing that. So I stopped decanting it into a cup now, and I just dole it right out of the jug now. So what I'm doing with the earth right now, that's the one I chose first, is I'm just going along where the curb touches the where the grass is, and it's adding depth to where most likely the soil will show through under the grass I'm going to add. And now the reason why I'm doing this with this clay-based wash is because a clay-based wash is based very heavily on a pigment and not on something as delicate and as fine as oils. That means there is a 3D texture quality to it, which is one of the reasons why I rely very heavily on these clay-based washes. It's because of the three-dimensionality that it provides. It has texture. Now, that doesn't always work in every situation, and there's many situations where you don't need it. You want a nice smooth texture, like cars and stuff like that. A lot of aircraft uses and stuff, you want a nice, beautifully smooth texture, so a clay-based wash for certain aspects of that is not what you're looking for. But for when you're doing dioramas, grit is good. And in clay-based washes, there is a lot of grit, and that's exactly what you're looking for. Because the three-dimensionality adds life, and life is what you're looking for in a diorama. You don't want flat and boring. Flat and boring is, well, to be honest, flat and boring. So you don't want to do it. Don't have to add much. Right. Now, some of this I'm going to take off with a sponge or with a cotton bud later. Not all of it, though. I want some of it to stay behind, but I won't know for sure how much until until it dries, and I know how dense it is. Just about knocked my fence over. That wouldn't be any good. Forgot I left the baby monitor on upstairs, and I can hear the family going on up there. I don't think you guys want to hear what's going on upstairs. It's not very interesting. Just the wife yelling at the kids. We're going to be getting ready to go to my local hobby show here in a few minutes. At least that's the hope. And discovered just a little while ago that Michael's is having a 50% off coupon day today. So we'll be making a stop at Michael's on the way. So I'm quite happy about that. Because I need some more cellular clay and some gas, so I'll be stopping to pick that up. And I get the big bag of cellular clay. It's like, I think, $35. With tax, it's like $45, I think. And so 50% off is a good thing. And there's I got two coupons, a 40% off and a 30% off. So. But the two coupons, I get the DAS and the cellular clay for a good price. Then I get to go to the local hobby show. Don't think I'll be spending much money there, though. They don't, sometimes they have some good stuff there, sometimes they don't. Depends. I usually buy something, though. At the very least, it supports the local vendors. Don't have that many local fellows around here, unfortunately. I wish we did. But my city's just not big enough to support it. We don't have enough hobby guys around here to attract them. The city's too small. It's not one of those, if you build it, they will come things. There's just not enough of us to go around here. There's only, in the entire province, there's only 1 million people. So, you're hard-pressed to get anyone for that kind of thing. You know, I'm going to switch to the street. Actually, no. I'm going to do this red cobblestone here first. And, do that, because I want this to dry a bit before I do anything else. Clean off that brush first. Just a bit of water in a cup and clean out the brush. Don't really want to take that and dip it in my concrete. Add this quite liberally. Oh yeah, the other thing is I popped out a couple of cobblestones. You can probably notice the holes in the street. So I took my hobby knife and popped out a couple of cobblestones with my hobby knife and then painted the interiors and in the hopes to add a little bit of visual interest to a long, boring landscape of cobblestones. Got the idea from Terry McDade, the pirate hunter. You guys know who he is. He's a YouTube modeler and does kit reviews and stuff like that. And I've made mention of him before in some of my videos. And he sent me a personal message there a couple of days ago and gave me the idea. I don't know if he did it intentionally or not, but it certainly gave me the idea anyway from the message he sent me. And after that, I was like, oh, that's what I'm going to do. So, I came down here, and actually right after I read his message, I came down here and popped in a couple of cobblestones with a hobby knife. And I was quite pleased with how it looked. I considered doing a bunch of them, but I thought that maybe it would kind of make the street look a little bit too old and beat up. And It didn't look old and beat up in the photograph, anyway. I mean, Terry made the point of suggesting that the street would have been well traveled by armored vehicles and stuff, and not extremely well maintained, because with the business of the war, things are, you know, priorities get shifted, and you know, maintenance gets a little lax because people are just trying to survive. So the maintenance of city streets and stuff like that sometimes gets left to the side. Andy's probably right. But for the sake of what it looks like in the photograph anyway, it didn't look like this street was too badly maintained. And the fence that's in the background, after looking at it for a while, it actually doesn't look like a brand new fence. It looks like it's been there a while, because it looks like it's got some staining on it and it looks a little old. But it doesn't look crooked. Well, at least not very much. But it's hard to tell. The photographs, it's a little grainy, so it's difficult to pick out some of the details. So, and I noticed that it's not a half-track that's in the background. It's a Jeep, Willie's Jeep. It's in the background. But a quick glance, it looked like the front end of a half-track, but it's a Willie's Jeep. Which, that's interesting, since I have two of them in my stash. I'd actually considered building one and replacing the A3 that I have on the diorama with the Willie's Jeep back here, and making the diorama even more accurate to the photograph. I still probably might, I don't know. It's not like I have to include those vehicles. I can just leave the Hellcat and the A3 off and build the Willie's Jeep and stick that on there if I want to. But if I did that in the photograph, there's a jumbo, and then there's the EZ8, and then back here is this part right here is the Willie's Jeep, and then there's like two guys standing here, and then way back over in the corner, off the shot here, is the house. So that would leave a big void right here with nothing in it. So that's why I put the Hellcat there. Fill the void. I don't know. You never know. I may move the A3 from here to here and put the Jeep there. We'll see what happens, I guess. I don't know. I'd have to build it anyway. So this is the last of the wash that I'm putting on. This is the light dirt, concrete, and sand mix that I have. I use this mix a lot. It's like an even mix, three parts each. And I put it in here, three equal parts. And I use it quite a bit. It's just I don't know, I like the color. It looks good to me. Makes me happy. Probably think about getting myself a large wash brush if I'm going to be making dioramas like this anymore. This brush is the biggest brush I have for doing this. And it's only that big. It's the biggest I got. I have other brushes, but they're for painting, not for doing washes. I don't want to do this with those. Clay-based pigments and paint brushes, well, they're a little hard on the brushes after a while. I don't know if you guys can see that or not, but the earth that I put along that curb, right, it's doing what I wanted to do, and it's leaching into the clay color that I'm putting on there, and blending it together, which is what I'm hoping it would do, making like a gutter stain. And then when I go to clean this off, I'm hoping it will still be there. It usually is. Every time I've done it before, it stayed. So, one thing you look for in a product is repeatable effects. And so far, most of the products I use have proven to have repeatable effects. Sometimes the effects they are repeating are good. Sometimes the effects they are repeating are bad. Like the Vallejo model error, the effects they're repeating are bad. They continually clump and don't bond well to the surface of the things that I paint them on, and they rip and tear and stuff like that. And so they've proven to be a unreliable paint. That's their consistent value. So far, MIG's reliability is in the positive, where it seems to be a fairly tough acrylic paint. It holds up to masking, and it doesn't clump or dry too much on the airbrush. And, so, you know, pluses and minuses. The UMP clay-based washes so far, they've been pluses for the most part. There's been a couple of negatives, but nothing. The only time that they were negatives is because I was trying to do things that they're really not supposed to be used for. But it's mostly because I was experimenting with them, which I am still. I'm trying to find all kinds of new uses for these. And I'm going to try another one involving figures here soon. A friend of mine is playing around with it. And if what he does proves fruitful, I may end up trying some experimentation with it. It'll be something I've never seen done before, that's for sure, if he manages to pull it off. It'd be cool. Full credit to him. Hey, Forbes. Forbes Hutton. He's a good doobie, that guy. Alright. I guess I lied when I said I wasn't going to show the entire wash being applied, because I did, and I have, and I'm done. So that's that. It didn't take as long as I thought it was going to take. Ah! Oh, crap. That's going to make a mess. Drop the cap on the floor and the cap had wash all over the inside of it. That's going to make a mess. So I didn't get it on my pants. That would suck. Great. So, now, what color? I think I'm going to use the dark dirt on the curb, and then I will call it a day. Because in a few minutes we're going to the hobby store and the hobby show, and hopefully that'll be an enjoyable event. My kids, both kids this year, are taking part. Both Sam, my four-year-old, well, almost four-year-old, he'll be four in May, and my seven-year-old, Kate, built models and are going to participate in the model show. They're both very excited. They don't care if they win prizes. They just want to go. They like being judges because it's a peer judge show. It's just a little tiny show, and so it's all just, you know, a bunch of local guys having fun. And the kids love taking part. And I'm a big supporter of the youth trying to be involved. So I get my kids to go, and a lot of the other modelers to get their kids involved and stuff like that. So we try to be as enthusiastic as possible for the kids. And the kids get little door prizes for participating, and, you know, they get a big kick out of it. And especially at their age, they have a whole lot of fun. So, it turns out to be like a family affair sort of thing. Maybe next year I'll get my wife to try and build something. That'll be a day now, wouldn't it? Yeah. I'm not going to hold my breath. I got asked how I was able to airbrush this curb in one go with my airbrush, just in a single pass, on my last video. I didn't really notice I was doing it. Apparently I just went and painted the thing in one pass. And I rewatched the video, and it didn't look like I was doing that to me, but to some people, apparently it did. And I have no idea. I just do it. I use the airbrush a lot, so I guess you get good at aim after a while. I'm not a very good painter, so I'm quite certain other guys can do it a lot better than I can. A lot more skill. And I wasn't going for neatness, nor was I going for accuracy. So if you were actually sitting here watching me do it, it probably wouldn't be anywhere near as interesting as it looked on the video. I'll never claim to having an original thought in any of my videos. Almost everything that I do came from other modelers and reading books and learning from other people. I very rarely have an original thought on my own, so I won't claim that. And anything you see me do is all done with smoke and mirrors. So, it's no magic. Half this shit is by accident. Happy accidents. Okay, so that's the wash on. Nothing else to do but wait now, and we'll probably take... I put it on pretty thick in some spots, so it's probably going to take, well, maybe an hour. And it'll be dry, and then I can start taking it off. But I won't be here, so I'll be away. Won't be till tonight. But it'll only be a few minutes for you guys, because the next time you see this, it'll be me taking it off. A couple of ways to take it off. You can take it off with cotton buds. You can take it off with a paper towel. You can take it off with a damp cloth. It's entirely up to you. I've tried all three methods, and the cotton bud, the damp cloth, and the paper towel all work. So the damp cloth is the one that's least environmentally awful, because you're just reusing the same rag over and over again. But it's a bit more aggressive because it has fibers, right, which can get into the cracks and accidentally pull too much wash out. That's the only reason I don't use it as much. And the fibers can get caught and stuff. And they tend to be thick, so it makes it a little bit hard to be accurate. That's the only thing about the cloth. I guess it depends on the cloth you're using. I guess they all come in different shapes and sizes. So. The next thing I'll do is the wash on this, but I haven't decided what I'm going to do with this yet. So that'll wait until later. So anyway, that's all I got for now. We'll see you in a little bit. So the wash is dry. It's been several hours now. And just setting this up. All you need... there's a whole whack of these little guys, cotton buds, some water, and a cup, and paper towel, depending on what you're doing. Now, for large, flat, smooth areas, I'll use a piece of paper towel, or kitchen towel, or whatever it is you want to call it, to remove it. But for the cobblestones, unfortunately, there's really only one way to take it off. Because this is foam, it's soft to a point, so if I wipe it with a piece of paper towel, it'll take off too much of the wash, and it will take it out of the grooves. The reason why I know that is because this is what happened to me on a couple of things so far. And I found that the best way to remove it is one brick at a time, constantly rolling the cotton bud. Now, most of you guys that are building dioramas and stuff like that will not be building them anywhere near as large as this silly thing. So you won't have to deal with this at the scale that I'm dealing with it. So you won't have several hundred of these things that you have to remove it from. You'll only have a few. Now, the Schiebel's Nashorn diorama had cobblestones on it, and I did the same thing, removing the wash, and it only took me about 15 minutes to remove it from that. And it was a section about that big, right? It took about 15 minutes. So it's not as cumbersome or as labor-intensive as it might appear. You can go quite quickly when you're not talking to a video camera and trying to make a point and trying to remember what it is you're trying to say and all that good clean stuff. And trying to come up with conversational ideas, either yatter, blabber, blabber. So, so that's what you see there is pretty much it. Now, it takes a little while for what you're doing to dry, and you'll see if you have to take off more, or you need to, or you've taken too much, and you have to put more wash on. Now, for the grassy areas, you can try taking it off if you want to take it off. You don't have to actually take it off. You can leave it there, but it will do that with your cotton bud. So, I don't usually use a cotton bud for that. I will use either a piece of kitchen roll or kitchen towel or paper towel, depending on what you want to call it. It's all the same thing. I'll dampen it and just give it a very gentle and quick wipe. The other thing you can do is use a stiff bristled brush and rub it. Now when you use this, it will blend it more than remove it. So you'll see it brightening the wash. So right now the wash is quite dark and like chocolatey, and when I rub it with the stiff bristle brush, it gets a more of a coppery tan color. So these are different effects that you can use depending on what it is you want to do. Now all kinds of grass is going to go on over this, so it doesn't really matter what I do here. Well, of course it does to a point, but I can use all three effects on here if I want. Now for removing it from the curb is much smoother. I will just use the paper towel and run it down, taking off the majority of the wash, but leaving it in the pits that I created with that brush when I made them. Sorry about the sniffles. I still have my cold. There. That's pretty much it for that. Now for these cobbles, I was actually going to use the paper towel again to remove it from them. Because it's a different kind of foam, it's a little bit firmer, I can actually use the paper towel without taking too much of the wash out. At least I don't think I can, or I don't think I will. If I do take out too much of the wash, I can always add it back. That's the thing about the wash. It's water-based and clay-based, so it's water-soluble, water-removable, and until you seal it with a flat coat or with a gloss coat, it's, you can, there's probably at least, I don't know, a good half a dozen applications you could try before it becomes a permanent addition to your diorama. It's very forgiving. Oils are also like that. There's a bit more of a stain quality with oils. They kind of seep in a bit further than a clay-based wash. So there's, that can be a bit of a bad thing, but it can also be a good thing. It depends on the effects. Again, there's a multitude of effects you can apply with oils. So it all depends on what it is you're attempting to go for. So I'm going to wait for this to dry, and then I'm going to come back, and you'll see what it looks like once, you know, what I've done here has dried. Right then, so I've now taken the rest of the wash off with a combination of cotton buds and paper towel and a stiff brush. Actually, pretty much in the way I showed you. And then, after I did all that, I went back with just a single cotton bud and picked out the odd brick and just gave it a little extra clean just to throw in a little bit of variety. That's it. That's all I did. That's probably all I'm going to do, I think. Once I flat coat this, I'll probably add some pigments here and there, mostly along in the gutters. But there'll be some in and around different areas just to add some tonal variety, like maybe some darkening here and some lightening here, that just, you know, like a patch of brown over here, like a darker brown, and a patch of lighter brown over here, just to make it look like, you know, the road isn't all homogeneous. That gets kind of boring that way. Right now it looks a little bit homogeneous to me. Not a lot, just a little, because there's patches coming through. So we'll see what happens. I may add it, I may not. Depends on what it looks like when I get further along. Right, so what's next is I have to seal this, right? So it's going to get a flat coat. So it'll be Tester's Dull Coat is what I'm going to spray this with. And then once the dull coat is on, I will start with the ground scatter, which is the dirt and leaves and sticks and grass and stuff like that. So that'll be the next thing. Not entirely sure how long this video is yet, so I think I'm going to stop it here, and in the next bit I'll do the groundwork. So right, you guys be good, keep your stick on the ice, talk to you soon.